Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the February 4th Board of Education meeting. Joy, will you start off with a roll call, please?
Mr. Wickliffe?
Here.
Mr. Shear?
Here.
Mr. Beveridge?
Here.
Mr. McCune?
Here.
Mrs. Martin?
Here.
Mrs. Felter?
Here.
Mr. Poland?
Will you all join me for the Pledge of Allegiance, please? Pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, well, we're going to start off. We've got three different informational presentations, and the first one we're going to start off with Maggie Cole, and she's going to talk to us and present to us the district notification solution presentation.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm thrilled to be able to tell you a little bit about a potential district notification solution. As you know, it is on the agenda for later this evening, but for now, let's talk communications. I know you all share in the philosophy that communications really is the backdrop of what we do here in this district. The most important thing in people's lives is our kids, and we have them every day. And so it is vital that we keep our parents informed about this most important thing in their lives, and that we have systems in place that help us keep them informed in an efficient and effective manner. On a recent parent district survey, 97% of respondents said that they felt informed about the Olathe Public Schools. Keeping our parents informed is part of our culture, and it's also an expectation of our parents. And as technology evolves and changes over time in this field, we need to make sure that we're keeping up with that change in technology. We've reached a new era in communications. 64% of Americans own a smartphone, and that number is only going to increase as the years go on. And we know that our parents are incredibly connected. We have more than 10,000 fans on Facebook and more than 6,000 followers on Twitter. And so we have this identified need for an integrated communication system. Currently, we have a means of sending an email to our parents, sending a voice message to our parents, sending a text message to our parents. But what we don't have is an integrated communication system that can do all of that, plus post to social media, plus post to the district website, all at the same time in a really efficient, effective manner. We also have a need for those messages to get out quickly. We have had a system in place for a number of years that can send voice messages and emails messages out for us, and it served us well, but it has its limitations. We have a voice message system that uses hard phone lines. So if I want to send a message to the parents of 30,000 students, it can take up to 3 days. So as you can imagine, that is not the most efficient way of delivering messages out, and particularly in the event of a crisis. So we need a system that can send out these kinds of messages in seconds or in minutes, not hours or days. We also need a system that's easy to navigate that allows us to differentiate messaging between different audiences and gives us the ability to have branded templates for our schools and for the district so that messages are polished and professional. We have identified a solution through RFP with Blackboard. We're so excited because this potential solution could meet all of these needs and then some. And there's a lot of benefits to going with Blackboard, but family and community engagement and informed communities on a daily basis and in the event of an emergency are two key benefits for us. Wanted to share just briefly a little bit the administrative dashboard of this site. It is easy to use. You can use it on your phone, on your mobile device, on your dashboard. You can write the message. You can click the different icons and quickly populate the message for different audiences. Email is easy to use. Social media, you can record a voice message right on your phone, which means that these messages get out quickly to our parents, which means that our parents are informed that much sooner. But the one thing that we are most excited about with this potential district notification solution is the option to have a customized mobile app. That means that our parents can go to the App Store, look for Olathe Public Schools, download the app, and have information about the district available at the touch of a button. We mocked up this look, so this is just a potential look and feel of what our app could look like, but we really can customize it to be whatever we want it to be. And it's exciting to us all the different ways that this could benefit our parents. Like I said, it could be customized to our district, accessible on any mobile device, easy to use, and information at the touch of a button. And that information would actually be pulled from our website, so as we update our website, it would update the app as well, so it would be current information. one thing that's really neat, it can integrate different calendars. So if you have kids in two different schools, you could integrate different school calendars with the district calendar in one spot. It can easily connect with teachers and with staff, and you can customize alerts through the app. I talked about other ways we could use this notification system to reach our families. But one other way we could use the system is to push notifications through the app. So anyone who has the app on their phone, in the event of emergency, if I push a notification out through this app, you see it right on your phone, you have information at your fingertips, and much, much more, because there's so much more to it. I wanted to share a couple scenarios just to give you an idea of the impact this kind of solution would have for us. On a typical snow day, everyone is waiting to hear, are we closing school or not? Currently, the way where our systems work, we have one person who posts to the district website and sends out an emergency text message. We have one person who contacts local media and posts to social media. We have another person who sends an email to staff, another person who sends an email to parents. Through this new system, one person on any kind of mobile device could populate all those messages and send them out, which means that our parents are getting that information that much sooner and can figure out what they need to do on a school day, on a snow day morning. Another scenario, in a crisis, we, from time to time, of course, you know, we have crises in our schools. An example I think of there's an emergency police matter in a neighborhood, and multiple schools are near that incident. We believe philosophically that our principals need to be dealing with what is happening in the building, with the crisis in the building or outside of the building. And it is our job in communications to send out those messages and keep our very connected parents informed. And we know that our parents are connected. We talked about that before. They're seeing information on social media and on the news. And we know that through a system like this, we can get out information quickly and alleviate any concerns our parents might have, which is a huge benefit. So, should this be approved tonight, we will start with implementation and training this spring, with late spring and early summer continued training, but implementation of some of our tools, some of the communication tools, and full implementation of the communication system in August. So I would be happy to answer any questions you might have, but we are just so excited about the opportunities this system could provide us.
I'll ask a couple. So let's say a parent is not necessarily very mobile device savvy. Mm-hmm. How do they sign up for just, say, email or the phone call alerts?
Is it all on
the website?
It's all actually tied to our student information system. So we have all that information. It'll be tied to it. So much like our parents get information now, it'll be a seamless transition for our parents.
And then the calendars, I'm so excited about mm-hmm. that. I'm hoping the answer to this is yes, but can I subscribe to the calendars that are available on the app, like I can to like holidays on my iPhone or any mobile device? You can subscribe like to national holidays or things. Can you subscribe to Briarwood's calendar?
Yes. Okay. So as a parent, if you download the app to your phone, you would choose the schools that you would like to follow.
Okay.
So if you've got kids in three different buildings, you can see all of that information on your app.
And then do I have to go to the app to see that information, or will it be in iCal?
I believe it integrates with your calendar.
Okay.
I believe it integrates with your calendar.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Maggie, is the information available to any patron within the district or just parents?
Anyone who wants to could download the app. But the email system that we would be sending out that is connected to our student information system would be just parents. But anyone who's interested could download the app and get information about our schools through the app. It'd basically be a very quick way of getting information that's already stored on our websites.
So access to calendars and things like that, anyone could?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
I see just the initial cost, and it's on the action item here tonight to approve, as you mentioned. Is there an ongoing annual maintenance fee or any additional cost there?
You do a great job of presenting. the cost that you see tonight on the proposal is an annual cost. This is a hosted solution. We will not be hosting it within the district. The current solutions we have, we are hosting. Those are our hard landlines. That's our server. That's our equipment that's running the system that we currently have. This is a hosted solution, so that's an annual every year cost.
We do have some current costs that we'll be reprioritizing in order to pay for this. Yeah. So is the intent then, is this going to replace like the parent view, student view, all of those type of things, or are those going to still be available? And
it does not replace that. Okay. This replaces the systems that send out email, voice messaging, Olathe alert, text messaging. That's what this replaces. And then it gives the added benefit of having the mobile app.
Okay. Will some of those be accessed through this then?
Yes.
Or are you still going to have multiple ways to log in to get the different information? How?
One of the cool things about the app is we can choose what information is available, what icons are available on the app. So we can have a parent view app on it. So someone could just go to the app and reach parent view and reach other things like that in one spot.
Okay.
I'm really excited about it.
As we're trying to get this more and more out, and as you said, a lot of our students have mobile phones, I'm just kind of curious of where we're looking at this, because a lot of times the kids come into school, if this is a way to communicate, and I don't know if this is more directed towards the parents, or if this is something that the children are going to have access to get information, and are we going to be opening up doors of them using their phones more often in schools? And there are some restrictions to that today.
This is really, I see the mobile app as really being a way to tie in different websites together, social media together into one spot. Anyone who is interested in learning more about the district or a school who would go to that website would benefit from having this app. Students absolutely could download the app and use the app, but I think the audience is mostly geared toward parents.
Okay.
And just for clarification, so it allows you to schedule, like pre-populate and schedule social media postings, kind of like Owly.
Yep.
Or okay.
Absolutely. Okay. So individual principals would have permissions through this system to send messages to their community. We would also at the district level be able to send to all the different school communities. You can divide by grade level. And then what's great about it is just that same message, you can choose if you want it to go to Twitter, if you want it to go to Facebook, as well as the other more traditional communication tools.
How about, I mean, knowing like it's National Educators Week, like 2 months in advance, can you schedule? Okay.
Yep, absolutely.
Good.
So then Dr. Berry's phone number will be out there so people could text him all the time? Is that?
Absolutely.
Very good. Any other questions? Well, this is thank you for the presentation. This is great. And as you mentioned, Maggie, it's great to have another opportunity to be able to communicate out to our parents and to the community itself, and trying to mobilize this. As you said, more and more people are using mobile phones, and so having these opportunities is going to be very beneficial. Thank you.
Thanks,
Maggie. Very good. All right, well, our second presentation tonight, Dr. Erin Dugan is going to come up, and she's going to talk about the update on boundary determination process. This is not necessarily talking about what the boundaries are going to look like going forward. This is about how did we get to where we're going with this. Is that correct?
You bet. We're about halfway through the boundary determination process, so we have no final decisions for you tonight, but I want to take this opportunity to update you on what we've done in the month of January for boundary determination for West, and then also tell you what's coming up this month, and then we'll be back to you guys in March with our first recommendation for boundary recommendations for you guys to consider and approve. We had three meetings in January, 130 participants on the committee. We did because we were really into maps as part of this boundary process, we did a map, and each dot shows where our participants are. So you see a nice sense the folks on the committee were well represented throughout the district. And then also it was important to us that we had a good number of parents, that we also had some staff, and then we had staff that were parents, and we had administrators that were parents. And again, just another look at those 130 folks that participated for three nights with us in January. We reviewed with the Boundary Review Committee what their role was, because that was important. We had 130 folks, and we were giving them lots of information and seeking lots of input. And from the beginning, we let them know that we wanted them to review options that we were presenting. They were representing their buildings, their neighborhoods, as well as their own personal thoughts. And they were providing us lots of input and feedback. They were not a decision-making group, but they were a group for us to bring ideas to. They gave us ideas back. we reformulated some of our ideas, took them back to them. So I will tell you, it was a wonderful group, and we got lots and lots of input. And I'll end my presentation tonight to show you where that input is specifically from all three nights. We talked about the role of the district staff. So they knew what we were doing and what we'd been doing, that we'd been studying the boundaries. We've been anticipating West and a need for boundaries for a number of years. We talked about that we were at this mode gathering lots of input about boundary options, and we were wanting their feedback, and that ultimately we'd present to you in March on a recommendation. We reviewed with them what you guys use in terms of guiding principles for boundary decisions back in 2005, and your responsibility to those guiding principles when these tough decisions are made. We spent a little bit of time in our first meeting talking about the growth in our school district and how we got to this exciting point of a fifth high school named Olathe West and a need to draw some boundary lines so we can determine the students that will attend there in August of 2017. And we took them through a little exercise in how our district's grown and where that growth's been. And we talked about if we didn't do a fifth high school, the numbers we'd be facing, just some reminders of some great decisions made by boards of education in a community that passed a bond in 2013, that we'd have two schools that were far too full if we didn't do a fifth high school. We talked about where the growth, where the unbuilt lots were in the northwest, west side of town, and we needed to be considering all those things as we looked at boundary options. We also spent a little bit of time reminding this group, or for some of them, introducing them to the concept of areas of choice. And so on this map, you can see the shaded with the lines drawn through. And we talked about the original purpose of our areas of choice was to draw enrollment to either northwest or north. And we said that throughout our evenings together, we talk a little bit about, were those still needed? The utility of those kind of in our growing district, and if they were still needed as we redrew boundary lines. And then we told them our goals, that we were gathering input specific to Olathe West and some boundaries. We also wanted input on either reducing or eliminating those areas of choice. And then any other boundary issues that would come up, and we knew they would, and in fact they did, related to looking at high school enrollment district-wide. And then we spent the next two evenings looking at six different boundary options. I'm not going through those with you guys tonight. The amount of input, conversation, dialogue, they looked at maps, they had demographics in front of them, but we looked at six different options, and we were looking at current school enrollment, projected enrollment at the time West would open. We were looking at the capacity of each building, where they'd be in 2020, where they'd be in 2024. And we were also watching and dialoguing about free and reduced lunch percentages at each of our buildings. And that was very important. And I'll talk in the end here about some common themes that the input told us. So again, folks are peeking. None of these were decisions, or we didn't land on anyone in particular, but we got input from all of them. Actually, the first three, I'll go back, were our initially, we had those prepared as we walked into the first session. But 4, 5, and 6 really came out of the input we received after the first session from the group. Hey, take a look at this. Did you think about this? Can you go back and get us numbers related to that? So 4, 5, and 6 are a direct result of this community process of gaining input and feedback. So there were 7 themes throughout the three sessions. The feedback from these 130 folks representing buildings and the community and parents and staff. Here's what they told us to pay attention to, make sure we're considering as we make these decisions. They talked a lot about that we need equity in our high school size and capacity, that we shouldn't have some schools really full and others not full in terms of our 5 high schools. There was concern from the group, and they wanted our recommendation as well as the board's final decision to be aware of the percentage of free and reduced students attending Olathe North High School in particular. There are questions regarding the diversity among all of our high schools, questions about safety, traveling distance, specific to the northwest Canyon Creek, Cedar Creek, and the potential of attending West, questions about driving on highways, distance, some of those things came up regularly throughout the sessions. We had a great conversation about splitting schools and was this a opportunity for us to not have as many middle schools split to different high schools, or even elementary splitting to different middle schools. So that was something they wanted us to continue to keep in mind. We talked about the impact of 21st century programs, where they are now, and kind of some plans for the future and how that would impact boundaries, and as well as some great questions about High School 6 and the land that was purchased as part of Bond 2013, as well as a need for Middle School 10 and questions from the community about should this, would this impact boundaries for Olathe West. And here we are on our next step. So we reviewed all of the input, and we will plan in February to take out to each of the high schools in more of a public forum a final recommendation that takes those six and the best of it and matches it up to those seven themes, and take a recommendation out to the public for another round of input. Now, not just select committee members, but open to anyone that would want to come to any of the four high schools. We are meeting on February 8th, 16th, 24th, 25th, and I'll show you the specific locations and dates. And again, a chance to share the recommendation and hear from the community things they want us and specifically you guys to be thinking about as you make that recommendation. Currently we have, so as soon as we ended this process, on the Olathe West website are all the presentations we made at each of the three sessions in their entirety in a PowerPoint. We had 27 pages of input. So if they wrote a note on a map or wrote a note on an index card or asked a question out loud, we memorialized that and have reported that out. So great fun if you had a chance. Get on and read through the 27 pages of input. You'll see these seven themes. They come really loud and clear in that input. But it's a lot of just fabulous input from this group. We also have on that site some frequently asked questions. That kind of repeatedly asked that we could answer for folks who would be going to that website so they didn't have. And then we've also publicly put out the dates and times for the four high school meetings in February. And again, there's the information. So that's what the website looks when you go to it. And you can see, you can click on the PowerPoints, the questions, our boundary review process, really trying to be incredibly transparent in this process and really seeking lots of input. And I'm pleased to say we've gotten lots, and I think we're going to end with a great solution. So stay tuned. More in March. Questions?
When you talk about consideration given to the splitting of schools, how many, I mean, do you know off the top of your head how many middle schools and elementary schools have splitting now?
I won't have the perfect number. So I believe there's five elementary schools that split to different middle schools. Mm-hmm. And then I want to say a small number of middle schools. But on that website, in the PowerPoint, because the question came up session one, I went back session two, and you'll see maps that show every elementary school and where it splits to its middle schools that split to high schools. There isn't a solution that reunites every school. We had great conversation about, is it harmful? It maybe doesn't feel good, but are kids doing okay? And some parents really enjoyed the chance to meet kids from different schools. So we had a great conversation. But you'll see in the final recommendation, we have reunited some schools because it makes good sense for boundaries as well.
And I assume that's based on the guiding principles of, we don't just see students as a check mark in a box. So it's their academic, social, and emotional, right, well-being. So
you bet.
I appreciate you paying attention to that and working
very
so
much
hard.
So.
And so the dates are on the Olathe West website and the
they're on
website.
And then we'll make sure we get them to you guys. We've put them out for the last 2 weeks through every building principal has pushed them out through parent information, so we've been very transparent. We've pushed that way before the boundary review committee finished, so they'd have those February dates on their calendar. The first one is February 8th at Olathe East, 16th at Olathe South, and then the following week is Northwest and North.
Thank you. That's a lot of meetings, so thank you.
No, you're welcome. They've been great. They really have been.
Any other questions? Thank you, Dr. Dugan. All right. In our last presentation tonight, we have John Hutchison come up, and he's going to talk a little bit about the capital needs and financing.
Yep. Good evening. We have met twice as a bond task force, and although we are not complete and have a recommendation for the board, I just wanted to quickly go through all the four threads that we've been discussing as a group. Our discussions revolve around all the items in our capital improvement plan, regardless of that we ultimately decide this is a capital outlay fund or this should be funded through a bond issue. We look at that plan as well as our five-year technology plan as part of the process. So we go through our four threads of growth: safety, security, technology, and aging facilities. We started with growth and recapped exactly what the focus was in our last bond issue, and obviously that was Olathe West. And in addition to Olathe West, we also had funding secured for a 36th elementary school. Yet that doesn't fund every future growth that the district's gonna see. We've been growing since the time that decision was made. And I indicated to the board at our last meeting that we really have five schools under watch in our 10-year enrollment projection, and we discussed with the group what those enrollment trends look like for those schools. We looked at various options that were reviewed with the board. Could boundary changes be used? Could an addition be used? Or do we need a new building to accommodate that growth? What came out of the discussions is we're looking at a 10th middle school potential immediately. Elementary number 36 will be needed around 2018, but the funding is already secured through the last bond issue. We need relief at Prairie Learning Center, and as you know, we have Mill Creek targeted as providing that relief. Oregon Trail Middle School will need an addition as early as 2023, so a little further out in that 10-year look. And a 37th elementary for Clearwater Creek. That doesn't mean these are the recommendations, we're still working through it, but these are the ones that are on the table. We then moved to our safety and security thread and reviewed a lot of great work that happened in bond 2013, where we really had a focus on safety and security. And as we look back at the work that we did, we find that in the research that we really were conforming with best practices that are being used around the country. We finally completed securing our classrooms by putting doors on every classroom in the district, a project that multiple boards have been working on for years. We completed the secured front entrances and the camera replacements at our front door and created that pinch point. We also did work on that secured event entrance. On the left, you see Frontier Trail before and after, and it created that very nice, bright, visible space for kids to wait for their rides after activities. And then we had this other list that was in bond 2013 of other items we knew we were interested in using in the district: keyless entry, exterior cameras, interior cameras, the audiovisual at the front door, electronic latches to control access to the office. We were looking at a potential panic alarm. We knew we had to cover our Y-care entrances, and we knew about this issue of our high schools having so many exterior doors. How can we possibly monitor it? Should there be a door open alarm? The good news is we made great strides in most of these categories. What's in parentheses in white is what's yet to be done, and usually it has to do with either a replacement cycle or the high school because of their size. You'd see that panic alarm was suspended. We actually found a solution that exists within our own system in our Cisco voice over IP phone system. We believe we can accommodate a panic type alarm using technology we already have. The one that is untouched currently is the door held open alarm. So that's something we'd look forward to in future funding. As you also recall, we took care of some egress issues in our elementaries, got rid of all the coats and book bags, and put lockers in our remaining elementary schools. Our focus now is on the gym floors. We know we need to replace many of the carpet and tile gyms, and looking for that solution. And the board's well aware that Countryside, we piloted a resilient product, and it's performing very well, and looks like it would recommend to be our new standard across the district for elementary flooring. So moving forward, we know we have more work to do on our keyless entry to upgrade the system. Exterior cameras, a real good example is our activity centers have no cameras on them, and we have large crowds there, so we may want to focus on those facilities. Cameras wear out, systems advance, so they're always within a five-year technology plan have replacements and upgrades to plan for. And then just continue replacement of those systems we've already started to implement. as well as looking at gym flooring. And another item that we've discussed is, do we have some playground issues or challenges that we need to make sure equipment is safe? If so, let's make sure we set some funds aside. Whether that's capital or bond is yet to be determined. Last night, we moved to aging facilities. And as you see, there's a long list of items very similar to the last bond issue. We replace things and other things age across our district. Anything from replacement cycles, do they need a jump start to work in our gymnasium? Pictorially, you can see we're looking at vehicle replacements. Do we do all of that out of our capital outlay, or have we gotten some vehicles because we've been trying to push off? Does it need a jump start? Do we need a little bit of bond dollars? We push a lot of snow in the winter. Luckily, we haven't had that lately, but all our vehicles double as putting a plow on the front, and it does show wear and tear on our vehicles. We've also suspended furniture replacements. We don't do a lot of furniture. We used to do a routine annual replacement of some of our furniture. And we're starting to feel that we need to get back on some of those cycles. We have a lot of asphalt in our district, and it's hard to keep up with it, especially large areas like our DACs or our high school campus. As they age and you can't patch anymore, those are larger replacements. And we have some areas where we have to work on our masonry, where I had to become a masonry expert, and I can't say this 10 times real fast. This is called face shell spalling. It's when water weeps into that brick, it pops the front off, it becomes like a sponge, and eventually it fails, and the integrity of the masonry goes away, and it needs replacement. And we have a couple of instances of that in the district that we need to take care of. We also have many of our elementaries have a cafeteria that at one time was used also as a gym, and we continued to rent. Now that there are more gyms at our middle schools and the rec center, we don't really rent these much. And it's labor intensive to pull up the tables, maybe do another activity in there. And as you can see, they're all tall ceilings. We're looking at putting a drop ceiling in there to cut the space in half for heating and cooling, and just leave the tables down, make it a permanent cafeteria. The continued energy projects that we always have of HVAC replacements across our district and window and door replacements. We made great strides in the window and door replacement, but there's still a few that we've identified. At our last meeting, I talked a little bit about bigger renovations to the front of Oregon Trail. This is a footprint of Santa Fe Trail. Similar challenges at Santa Fe as Oregon Trail. It basically, we are now pinching everybody into the office, and these offices weren't designed for that kind of traffic. They also weren't designed for the collaborative nature of a middle school, where the principal has to meet with and teams have to meet, and you need conference space to meet with parents. So we're looking at ideas on how to renovate the front of Santa Fe, bump it out slightly, and create that unified space for the SRO officer, the nurse, and the administrative team. Finally, we moved to technology with the group. And we had four goals in our last bond issue of providing more access and enhancing that infrastructure, upgrading our digital classrooms, and replacing the aged equipment that we had in the district. And we did tremendous on making inroads on that list. We increased the access through the 2-to-1 initiative at the elementary. That's 9,300 iPads. And then at the middle school, 1-to-1 with 8,000 iPads. Along with the implementation of that, we had to enhance our infrastructure and network hardware in order to accommodate those devices, and that work was done. We upgraded our digital classrooms, added Apple TV to help with the iPads, the teachers and students exchanging information and displaying information through their new technology devices. And we caught up on those replacement cycles that we had fallen behind on. As I said, we focus on that 5-year plan, and the good news is in both the old and the new plan, there's always a focus on the student. A lot of times we see line items about a support piece of software, but really over 50% goes to the devices, another quarter goes to the infrastructure to drive those student devices, and you see there another large piece of the pie is as we grow and build new additions or just accommodate more kids, we bring in more devices for that. The software applications and the printers are a very small piece of our plan. Looking forward, it's you see a lot of mirrored categories because of replacement cycles and accommodating growth. We need work with infrastructure, our audio, visual, telecommunications, and the safety and security that we discussed a few moments ago. We worked with the group to try and, with some symbols, Dr. Dugan did a great job to kind of guide them through these pieces that Sometimes you need additional staff when you add more to your platform, other times you don't. So we walked them through the various pieces of infrastructure. Besides the replacement cycle items on this list, as we move towards an enhanced technology initiative at the high school, that will put more that'll tax our network more, and we'll need more switches, more routers. That will cause us to have to look at additional staffing in order to accommodate a larger network. Audiovisual, the putting Apple TV, AV in our elementary gyms. We have a space in the gym where a lot of collaboration can happen and activities for kids, but we don't have any ability to do audiovisual. We have upgrades that we need in our district video production and the IRC. They'll be staffing there to maintain some of these devices as well. While we don't have a lot of printers in our district anymore, they've really diminished. We still do need printers. They're not staff intensive, but they do have to go through replacement, as does our phone system. Eventually, you have to replace the server that drives our voice over IP system, as well as just the desktop phones. There's a couple support applications that in our five-year plan will either need updating or replacement, our time management system, our document imaging system, and our special education hardware and software. Finally, in student devices, we'll want to maintain our replacement cycles. We'll have to look at our more intense equipment in our CAD labs and digital photo and e-com programs. And although it feels like we just got into the iPads, they will not last forever. We're in our we've just done our second payment on a four-year lease at the elementary level. So that lease will lapse in two more years, and we'll decide, do we want to purchase replacement or do we want to go into another lease? 3 years, we'll have we'll be approaching the end of the life on the middle school iPad. So we have to see how are we planning on the replacement cycle for that. That kind of deployment and collection of those units also is labor intensive, whether it's year to year or when you're replacing all of the units at the end of their life. And finally, we talked about that high school initiative and devices and peripherals, and that will definitely require staffing. We heard from the group that in order to put 9,000 laptop-type devices, more production-type devices at the high school level, we may be facing even a staff member at each high school. So it wouldn't be prudent if we can buy the equipment. We definitely have to have a plan for how do we staff that. And if we look at that staffing plan, then it starts to compete with all staffing plans of, do we need additional counselors? Do we need teachers for better class sizes? So the conversation is still going on exactly, do we move forward with that initiative? And if so, how do we come up with a staffing plan? We then turned our attention to that. We did all of that work without a price tag on anything, in order that people really think about what's a priority to me without knowing the cost. And Tuesday, when we get back together, I'll bring back all the costs that are associated with those after they've had time to mull it over. But we did introduce them to our debt curve, and the board's very used to this. This was our debt curve projection when we did bond 2013. And as you know, we promised not to exceed 17 mils. We were at about 16.5, and it's actually coming down much quicker than we had anticipated because of some of the economic conditions. So we explained how we purposely and strategically work with this debt curve, that we have needs and we try to hold them off until the curve starts to come down, and really we keep it up at a very flat level through the years so we don't see these major fluctuations. They seem to understand why boards of education's work towards that. And finally, we try to do a 10,000 foot briefing on the block grant and how it might impact some of our capital and plan decisions. And we talked to them about pre-block grant, that our pre-block grant formula was really developed over years and added pieces to it. And it really had three major sources of funding that would flow through the pipes. And we would come up with operating funds, capital outlay funds, and bond funds. And they would fill silos. The operating funds were to help teacher salaries, supplies, utilities. The capital outlay were to flow to a silo that handled our maintenance and our technology and our equipment. And then the bond flowed into new buildings and additions. However, under the block grant, that operating piece got frozen up. And some legislative changes were made that suddenly you could actually use that capital outlay for something else. So we had to kind of open the valve on capital outlay to help us with operating and start to shut it down on the other side for maintenance, technology, and equipment. And how it affects the bond task force is, do we need to open the valve on bond funds to start assisting with maintenance, technology, and equipment and close off the new construction piece? Because if our growth is slowing or is in one section of our town, do we need to adjust all of these valves? And that will lead us to Tuesday night's discussion of how, out of what source of funds should be funding this capital plan and to what degree. So on Tuesday, we'll talk about scope and sizing. How much of this capital improvement plan do we believe we need? When do we need it? Is it a capital item? Is it a bond item? And then bring a recommendation forth to the Board of Education for their acceptance. Questions?
John, you had 2% as your for the debt curve.
Yes.
How does that compare to recent years, the recession, pre-recession percentages?
We are told by the county assessor to use 3 to 4%. I use 2, and I have another slide that does 3. We've hovered around. We've actually lost assessed valuation in the past, but we used to gain a lot more than that. That's the reason our curve's coming down quicker now. We planned 2%, but we had gained 4 or 6% in different categories. So the same mill rate is raising more money, and is not, and therefore we don't need to raise more on top of that to service our current debt. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
2% is very conservative right now. They don't know, but Tuesday, the other piece of the model, just to put the board at rest, the other assumption is zero bond and interest state aid. We don't want to plan anything not knowing if it's going to be in a new formula or not. We know it's reduced right now, but conservatively, we'll assume nothing's going to come our way and properly size any potential issue around that.
But currently, it's 11?
11%.
And it was 30-something?
30. I have a couple questions.
Yes.
The enrollment projections. I remember at the beginning of the year, there was a lot of hubbub because this year was a little different that we had the block grant. So our enrollment projections were had a little more weight this year as far as applying for the extraordinary needs funding.
Yes.
And in traditional years, they've been kind of a projection based on similar factors, but it was more to prevent, it was for budgeting purposes, right? To prevent having to republish the budget should we, we were over projecting sometime, right. And then we could always contract the budget back without having to have the extra board meetings and so on and so forth. So anyway, going forward, the enrollment projections, we have faith that these are accurate. And can you tell me the current student count versus, you know, on the count day?
Okay. We've always projected what we believe enrollment is. It's in the budget document that we had put a buffer of 400. It was delayed this year. If I remember back on the official date, we were up 140 or
163.
Thank you. 163 or now, and we are now at 420.
And so, we started the semester at 420. Yep.
Right. So unfortunately, they came a couple months later than the official count date. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's pretty much where we had projected. Similarly, we've tried to adjust models and be conservative that we make sure that we're not over projecting going forward and adjust some of the factors.
Right. And I'm not implying that we were inflating numbers,
no.
But it wasn't as important necessarily to be spot on for the budgeting documentation because it would eventually adjust down after the count date. And so we're actually over what we projected.
Correct.
Now. So this document we can have faith in.
Yes.
And so anybody pointing and saying, yeah, your history of projections is inaccurate, right?
Correct.
Okay, just want to get that on the record. And then I had a couple more questions. Just let me, I dog-eared my papers. Thank you for this information, by the way. You mentioned like Briarwood Elementary's cafeteria, that's a multi-purpose room, and they do plays and all that in there. If you do decide to include that piece, and if we go for a bond, where would the plays be, even though we're not renting out gym space? Would they be moved to the gym, or?
You could still use that space for that production. It's just the daily pulling of the tables. We try to get it established for the, most of the school week, but if there's a play, you could, there'd still be removable. Some of the schools, that stage is double-sided and it faces the gym. I mean, I just didn't want to say that because I'm not sure every school is that way. So they would move to the gym instead and do that.
Okay.
And it's not decided that we're going to go forward with that, but it's something we're exploring with the group.
Do, of course, a cost efficiency
Absolutely.
Study on lowering
Absolutely.
The ceilings and everything. Okay. And technology, you mentioned that we caught up with the replacement cycles of aged laptops and desktops. Now, traditionally, under the old formula, we would then, I would assume that we would then start funding the replacement cycles under capital outlay then, not going forward having a bond every time, right?
That's correct. Normally, we would have done that under capital outlay, but we're exploring what are these pressures that are going to be put on capital outlay. Can we continue that? Also, as we make a decision on a high school technology initiative, would that reduce the numbers? We'll still need them, but does it reduce how many you need to replace because now each student has a device in their hand versus how many are on a cart or in this lab? But we still need teachers and all support staff having computers.
But I know our track history is we're not, just because a desktop is aging out, we're not necessarily going to automatically replace it. We
correct.
Have an overarching technology plan as well, right?
That's correct.
Okay. And then if you don't mind, I just have a couple more. The support applications, like the time management, the hardware, software, would those typically be in capital outlay under the previous formula, or
we've done both?
We've
done both capital outlay and bond. Traditionally, capital. Of late, we've had to utilize bond in order to put those systems in. The longer standing ones, like a financial software, last 20 years, so it makes sense for a bond purchase.
Okay, and when you say of late, would you say like the 2013 I know included some of that. Would the 2007 bond have included it? Do you know?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so it's not just something we're doing.
No.
Okay, randomly here. And then, so your post-block grant graphic, when you mentioned that the operating now, we've been unhandcuffed on the capital outlay funding source. When you say that we're using more of it in the general for what is now the general fund, can you explain a little bit more on that?
Certainly. With our operating funds frozen, we have to look to capital outlay to fund some of our operating expenses. We haven't done a lot of it, but a small amount of staff can be charged now to you can use a transfer from capital outlay to handle some of the staff. It's kind of a slippery slope that we're trying to be cautious about for two reasons. As I've told the board, the fallback position, not knowing what a new funding formula looks like in August of 17 when we open Olathe West, we're holding that capital outlay and trying not to use it in case we have to shift a lot, use that to help fund staff for that new high school. So that's one big piece of it. The other is just, other operating pieces will put pressure on trying to pull that capital over. And the question is that okay? Because maybe you'll sell a four-year bond to help with the things you used to do in capital outlay. We're getting to that choice time because we're starting to see the need to go into capital outlay going forward. Does that make sense?
Thank you. Thanks for articulating that, because from what I'm aware of, we have not encroached into that fund much as of yet, as a philosophy, as a board at least. And so what I'm hearing you saying is we are now at a tipping point where we're going to have to decide. They've unhandcuffed that fund. So theoretically, what will our philosophy be moving forward?
Our maintenance and technology needs outweigh the revenue stream and capital outlay.
Period, no matter Period. What our philosophy is on?
Okay. Correct.
Okay.
You can sure keep up real close, mm-hmm. but technology, relatively new coming to school districts, if you really kind of think back, if a formula has been around since the early 90s, the amount of technology has not, and it's putting a burden on how do you keep up with maintenance and all these things that look like they belong in capital. They can't all go in capital anymore, so you get selective about what should I put in capital and what should I do in bonds.
Okay.
Because we're at an 8 mil cap.
At an 8 mil cap, okay. And historically, has capital outlay been able to keep up with our 5 to 7 year replacement cycles and everything?
I think we've always subsidized with some bond dollars, or had it been able to?
We've done a really good job of keeping up with the replacement cycle for the most part.
Okay.
It's the additionals.
Yeah. But we've also delayed and expanded those recycles too, though.
That's mm-hmm. correct. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for the clarification. I'm sorry to get into the weeds, but I think it is okay. important. And mm-hmm. and I think we need to communicate with the legislative decision makers that, you know, the fundamental philosophies will have to shift going forward if the block grant intends to stay in place or whatever, because it's important for all local funding revenue sources to have that consideration going forward, so we kind of know. We just need predictability and sustainability, and right now it's not here. I'm hearing you say that because we're having to kind of plan around it.
Because we could have no new initiatives, but we just faced an increase in benefit cost, an increase in transportation costs. With a balanced budget 1 year, the next year, where do you go for that? We'll start turning our eyes to capital outlay.
Right, okay, thank you.
I'd like to add two more quick comments, if I could. The increased flexibility that the legislature gave us for our capital outlay comes into play in the first levy after we passed that resolution and that budget. So we did that. It became law July 1st. We passed our budget in the fall. The first levy on capital outlay into the new flexibility just came to us in January. So now we have dollars that had the increased flexibility. The other thing is, the history of our district, we've been up and down on capital outlay in terms of how much we've levied, trying to keep our tax levy somewhat level for our patrons. And in my time here in 9 years, once we had a half of a mil of capital outlay. So when you start talking about committing funds out of capital outlay, if it's going to fluctuate that much, it becomes very difficult. In some years, we were 3 or 4 mils. Mm-hmm. As recent as last year, we were under 5. So we've always used that as a balancing act. So we have to be careful how much we commit.
And didn't we take a little bit of heat for not maxing it out this year? Is it the capital outlay mils that we didn't max because of our theory of keeping it relatively stable?
Correct. We did that again this year.
It's because our ongoing philosophy has been to keep it for our patrons, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, John. Appreciate that. At this time, we'll go ahead and take a comfort break, and we will return back here at 7 o'clock. Thank you. All right. So, Maggie, we'll go ahead and get started with some recognitions now.
Thank you. We have numerous recognitions tonight. I'd like to welcome all of our distinguished guests. We're going to begin our recognitions tonight with a community partner. I'd like to ask Heather Schoonover from Community Development and Cindy Von Felt from the Olathe Public Schools Foundation to come forward to help with this recognition. Tonight, we'll be recognizing the Olathe Health System, a premier business partner with the school district through numerous programs that serve students, staff, and school families. I'd like to ask the following to come forward to be recognized. Dr. Scott Williamson from Arbor Creek Family Care, Dr. Harlan Opie from Midwest Surgical Associates, Mike Jensen, Vice President of Marketing and External Affairs, Darren Odom, Director of Business Development, and Mark Dwyer from Rehab Services. While there are numerous ways to describe the support and partnership of the Olathe Health System, here are a few highlights. The Bridging Education and Medicine Program, or BEAM, allows secondary students to benefit through a variety of programs, including the Physician's Breakfast, where a panel of OMC physicians talk about their specialties. Students also benefit from the BEAM Career Night, internships, shadowships, and volunteer and community service opportunities through BEAM. The Olathe Health System has also been a great supporter of the Olathe Public Schools Foundation and has to date donated more than $1 million to the foundation over the years. Donations to the Student Health Emergency Fund and contracts for access to care at urgent care and other clinics have provided students with urgent health needs a same-day physician visit. Olathe Health Systems has provided positive collaboration for the care of our student athletes. Through 4 full-time, on-site certified athletic trainers at each of our 4 high schools, students receive outstanding injury and rehabilitation support. First graders annually have been taking field trips to Olathe Medical Center to participate in Play Hospital, a program designed to introduce young students to health careers and to help familiarize them with hospital providers. These are just a few of the many amazing ways Olathe Health System has impacted our schools. We applaud the vision and support that Olathe Health System brings to our school community. Thank you.
Thank
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good to see you again.
Next, we'd like to recognize Callie Ray, a sophomore from Olathe South High School. Callie, if you could come forward, along with Principal Phil Clark and District Athletic and Activities Director Tim Brady. Callie recently received the top honor in the 16th annual Martin Luther King Jr. Celebrate Diversity competition. She won the Best of Show Award in the contest, which is sponsored by the Olathe Public Schools and the Olathe Human Relations Commission. Her entry and essay beat out more than 4,000 entries submitted by 6th through 12th grade students. This year's theme was Love Illuminates Life. Congratulations, Callie. And is your family here tonight? If so, we'd love for them to stand and be recognized as well. Next, we'd like to recognize two outstanding educators for receiving the Kansas Horizon Award. With the following, please come forward. Lauren Brown from Heatherstone Elementary and her principal, Ruth Wagner. And Jocelyn Cummings from Mission Trail Middle School and her principal, Rochelle Waters. The Kansas Horizon Awards, which are sponsored by the Kansas State Department of Education, recognize the exemplary work of teachers during their first year in the classroom. Brown and Cummings were two of 32 teachers from across the state honored with the award this year. They are both now in their second year of teaching in the district. Congratulations to you both. And are your families here tonight? We'd love for them to stand and be recognized as well. Congratulations. The next recognition is of Becky Gianola, a buyer in the district's purchasing department. Becky, if you could come forward, along with Merle Hastert, Director of Business Services. Becky recently received national recognition, earning a Senior Professional in Supply Management certification. This is a globally recognized certification that has been earned by other dedicated purchasing professionals in more than 90 countries across 6 continents. Congratulations to you, Becky, on this accomplishment. And is your family here as well? We'd love for them to stand and be recognized as well. Congratulations. And finally, we have a special recognition presentation from Olathe Relay for Life. I'd like to ask the following volunteers to come forward. Amy Grother, event chair, Kim Gramling, Gerald Gentry, and Cindy Hayes.
I'm Amy Grother, and on behalf of the Relay for Life of Olathe and the Olathe community, we would like to present this plaque to the Olathe School District in appreciation of your support and sponsorship to the American Cancer Society. The Relay for Life is an event held in our community and communities across the world where we come together to celebrate cancer survivors, remember loved ones lost, and fight back against this disease. Since we are a not-for-profit organization, having the Olathe School District support us with the facility at no cost, it means that we have less event expense and we have more money that can go directly to the American Cancer Society. With every dollar raised, we fight back. We are funding research for 47 Nobel Prize winners who have participated in cancer research, treatments, and prevention. We are funding the development of pap smears, PSA screenings, mammogram screenings, and we have funded the research that links smoking directly to lung cancer and getting SPF ratings on sunscreen. On the local level, we are helping to fund our Road to Recovery program and the Hope Lodge. Road to Recovery drives patients to and from cancer treatments that are unable to drive themselves. It's an amazing program full of volunteers. You might even see one of our vehicles out and about because Olathe Kia Subaru just donated one and have it fully decorated. The Hope Lodge is located in downtown Kansas City, and it is a place that cancer patients can stay while they're getting treatment with their family. It's at absolutely no expense. They can stay there. They don't have to worry about their hotel cost. They don't have to worry about getting to and from treatments because somebody will take them. They can stay at the Hope Lodge and be surrounded by support. We would also like to thank two district employees, Dennis Meehan, for working with us to secure our location each year, and Sean Brumbaugh, who is out at the Olathe District Activity Center with us, who gets there Friday morning at sunrise, stays all day while we set up, stays all night with us, and is out there half of the day on Saturday. He's probably there a good 36 hours, so. And we couldn't do it without you guys. We really appreciate it. And I would like to invite you all to the Relay for Life. It's on Friday, June 10th, 6 p.m. We have some save the dates at the Olathe District Activity Center. We'd love to see you on our track. Thank you. And one more thing, the Olathe community, we've raised over $1 million to date.
And that concludes our recognitions tonight.
So you all marked your calendars for June 10th, right? So what you said, June 10th?
Kelly?
Ready to go?
Public comments. At each regular meeting of the Board of Education reserves limited time for individuals wishing to address the board. We request that individual speakers limit their comments to 5 minutes. The clerk will monitor the time and notify the speaker when the 5 minute time limit has expired. Please direct your comments to the entire board. If a response is appropriate, the president will respond or refer to another individual. In an effort to respect privacy, we ask that speakers refrain from discussing personal complaints involving individual staff members or students. Those speaking are advised that public comments are videotape recorded for broadcast on the district's educational access channel and audio tape recorded as a matter of public record. Individuals addressing the board should come to the podium at the front of the room and state your name and the address. Is there anybody here this evening who'd like to address the board?
Seeing none, then we'll move on and we will pick up with the action consent items. We've got action consent items 5.01 to 5.11. Is there any one of these consent items that any of the board members would like to discuss? If not, looking for a motion to accept.
Move to approve consent agenda items numbered 5.01 to 5.11 as presented.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Whitcliffe, a second by Mr. McCune. Joy?
Mrs. Felter? Mr. Whitcliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Very good. Now we have action bid contracts and agreements. 6.01, instructional materials, grade 7 social studies, digital licenses. Any questions? If not, I'll look for a motion, please.
Motion to approve the purchases of Experience State History student licenses for Kansas Journey from Gibbs Smith Education for $56,235 from Gibbs Smith as presented.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Beveridge, a second by Mr. Whitcliffe. Joy?
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Whitcliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
6.02, textbooks, high school social studies, advanced placement, European history. Any questions?
Move to approve the purchase of textbooks, high school social studies, advanced placement, European history from Cengage Learning for $39,600 as presented.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Whitcliffe, a second by Mr. McCune.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Whitcliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
All right, now we've got 6.03, 6.04, 6.05. Greg, you want to kind of walk us through these a little bit, please?
Yes, we can. Change orders in excess of $20,000, excuse me. We have two tonight. A PCO number 119. The building was designed, this is West High School, was designed with high wind shelters on the ground floor. These are shelters that would shield students in the building from 250 mile an hour winds in case of that event. The spaces were designed with standard doors, frames, and door hardware. In order to fully implement the storm shelter, we really need a special door that has a special hinges, heavier weight, and this three manual lock system. This change order allows us to replace the sort of standard doors and hardware that were included in the bid documents with high wind doors to match sort of the design of the space. And the cost of that is $80,035.13. The reason that we went this way was to make sure that we were in budget for the rest of the project before we decided to expend the money on these high wind doors. It hasn't impacted the construction schedule, but it's now time to make that decision as to what kind of door we're going to put on these spaces. PCO 173 is a little more complicated, if that wasn't. A large portion of this building is air conditioned and heated using a VRF system, which has approximately 85 small rooftop units. Because the size of these units and the capacity of these units varies so much from one manufacturer to the next, the design engineer has to sort of pick one manufacturer and use that as the basis of design for the project. And they chose a product manufactured by Daikin. And that's how the building was designed. On bid day, we found that the low bidder for the equipment was LG, which is a comparable system, but it does require more units to provide the same amount of air conditioning and heating. The bidder accommodated that in his bid. He included the extra equipment in his bid. What wasn't included was the electrical for those additional units, the electrical circuits, and the fact that some of these units are larger and need a larger circuit. The construction manager at that time estimated this additional electrical to be $100,000. The LG equipment was $197,220 low. Even with this $100,000, it was still the low equipment. That's who they recommended, and that's who we accepted. We've been negotiating this change order since then, and now have a final change order amount of $47,014.54. For this work. We had anticipated approximately $100,000. It has turned out to be about $47,000. And that's the change order for PCO number 173.
If I understood that correctly, though, net we're still less when you take into account the changes. Is that right?
We were $97,000 less had this been $100,000. And now that it's $47,000, we're another $50,000 to the good. It was still the low bid by a considerable amount. We just now have this sort of extra cost that we need to add back in for electrical work.
Any other questions? If not, you want to go ahead and talk 6.04 also?
Yes, we only have one bid tonight, and that bid is for theatrical lighting. This is the stage lighting for the black box in the main auditorium. We had two bids. One bid was not complete. So we really only ended up with one bid. It was less than our estimate. It's not unusual in something as specialized as theatrical lighting to only get one or two bids. It did have one bid alternate that we're recommending that we accept. These lights above the stage are mounted on a grid that can be lowered so that you can adjust the lighting and then raise it back into place. What's in the base bid is a manual system with ropes and pulleys to lower that. This bid alternate allows for motorized hoist to raise and lower it. It's recommended is obviously more efficient and safer to use the electrical system. We say we have a bid tonight for theatrical lighting, and that's our only bid tonight.
Any questions regarding that? And if you don't mind, we can go ahead and put 6.03, 6.04 together in a motion.
Okay. I would move to approve 6.03, the change orders in excess of $20,000 for Olathe West High School as presented, and also 6.04 trade bids for Olathe West to accept the bids listed in the bid summary as presented.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. McCune and a second by Ms. Filter.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Wycliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes. All right, while you're up there, Greg, you want to just real quickly on the sewer easement for the future elementary school?
We will. This is a very basic sewer easement that we're, this is for the elementary school site we own in Canyon Creek Highlands. As a part of the purchase agreement, the developer was required to bring sanitary sewer to our site. He's now opening up that part of the subdivision and beginning work on it. So he's running sewer to all of the residential area, and he wants to run the sewer onto our site at the same time. This is a small permanent easement to allow the pipe to come onto our property and a temporary construction easement to allow him to build it. I think it's 15 feet long. So it's a very small easement on the back of the property, and we anticipated this location.
And so this won't interfere with how we ever set the school or anything else. It was going to need to be put in this place
we have a footprint for the building that indicates how we think that the building will fit on the site and what kind of parking and playground, and basically a preliminary layout, and this works with it just fine. This is the location we requested the sewer to come to.
Pretty good. Any questions? Then I have a motion for 6.05.
Move to grant permanent and temporary sanitary sewer easements for a future elementary school as presented.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Wycliffe and a second by Mr. Beveridge.
Mr. Wycliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
All right, 6.06. Travis, would you like to come up and talk a little bit about what we're doing for aging facilities?
Yes, I can. Good evening. We're moving forward with our aging facilities project, so we're a little less than halfway done with our bids. So what is being presented tonight is bid package 2 and bid package 3. Bid package 2 is our door and window replacement project. We actually split it up into two bid packages to kind of even out the amount of work. We had 7 schools, so we had 4 on one, on 3 on the other. And then for bid package 3, it was our lighting replacement project. One little note on bid package 2, B, we did take an alternate for a fiber reinforced panel door, which is a fiber door with aluminum frames. It won't rust and is more durable. Actually, the alternate ended up as a deduct alternate compared to our standard hollow metal door and frames. So we're recommending taking that deduct alternate as well. And so we had 3 bidders on our bid package 2A, 2 bidders on our bid package 2B, and then 8 on our bid package 3, which is our lighting replacement project for Olathe South and Olathe North. And we'll be coming forward next month with the remaining packages for aging facility 16, which will be the carpet installation. If you remember, we did the bulk purchase carpet last month, and then we'll do our ceiling tile and grid replacement, and then our restroom renovation as well.
Been quite busy, haven't you?
Just a little bit.
Very good. Any questions? Seeing none, can I get a motion for 6.07, please?
Motion to accept the bids listed in the bid summary as presented, 6.06.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Beveridge, a second by Mr. Wycliffe.
Mr. Wycliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
All right, then we got 6.07, 6.08, Rita. Can you come up and just kind of talk a little bit about the special education software, please?
Sure. We were notified, it's been quite some time ago now, that the company that owned our existing IEP software, the company's name is NetKimia, the software was called NetIEP, that company had been sold, and the company that bought them immediately end-of-lifed that particular product. So we've known for some time that we would be needing to look for a new product for our special education records. We had been on that product for 10 years or more. So we began a search. Lainey Fasulo, along with her staff and people in technology, began that search, ended up writing the RFP to put out to bid, and we've come back with the responses that you see there tonight. Our recommendation is to go with the special education module that comes with Synergy. That's our student information system. We've had that up and going live now for a year and a half. It fits very nicely with that package. There's no push and pull of data between the two systems. They're just all integrated. And we really made a unanimous decision that that was in the best interest of everyone to go with that package.
Will all the data from our former software upload into that? Are you going to have to archive it or
No. Well, yes and no. We will be archiving some of it. Some of it, the special education department may not want to move over, depending on the age of it and how long the students have been gone from the district. We will pull into it, just like we did with the student information system. We will pull as much data into it as we need to pull into it. And then we'll also give the opportunity for the special ed department to really look through all of their records, as we did with every time we've made a software conversion like this. It gives you an opportunity to really look closely at your data, do a lot of cleanup and do a lot of cleansing of data, and making sure everything is new and fresh and solid.
So I know some of our special ed students are here till age 21,
correct,
right?
Mm-hmm.
So will their kindergarten and pre-K IEP still be available?
If they're still an active student, those records all come over. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So I noticed that it does talk, and you mentioned it does interface with the SIS. Are there SIS systems out there that would have had this incorporated in this, or is this a special software specifically for this that we have to have? Or just trying to figure out why you have so many different databases out there.
Most student information systems do not include a robust, full-functioning special education application. It's special ed is kind of its own software, so to speak. Most systems are standalone on their own. So it's, when we looked at Synergy in the beginning, that was one of the things that drew us to that package, is that it had gradebook, it had student information, it's had special ed, it has a lesson module, a curriculum management module, an online assessment piece. So that was one of the unique features that we liked about Synergy, is that it did have a lot incorporated in it that wouldn't force us to go off on these standalone products, and then you're pushing and pulling data between the two systems. And so that was a real plus when we started looking at Synergy. Of course, at that time, we were still running NetIEP, thought we were going to be able to run that for several more years, thinking that we'd get, you know, 4 or 5 more years out of that. But the product sold, and they decided not to continue with it.
Very good. Any other questions?
No, I'm not sure how big a deal this is, but the attachment that we have has 239.071, and then it's 239.017.
Oh, it's probably a typo on my part.
I don't know if that would cause us to have to revote or.
It's whatever the motion is that we make. So what's the number we need?
Let me look here. Hang on.
17 or 71. Nice catch, Joe.
All right, Joe. Wow.
You earn your keep tonight.
You have about 54 bucks in your pocket to pitch in.
239.071. I might point out, if you look at that spreadsheet of the three vendors that did respond, you notice one of them is considerably lower. Well, not considerably lower. It was 190,000 versus 239. But you notice that they did not meet near all the functionality that we requested. The other one that's in there, more closely matched our functionality, but you notice the difference in cost, almost $600,000 more. It's because of the way they charge for us to use their Medicaid billing service. And Synergy, there is no additional charge to use that Medicaid billing service. Their product charged you by the amount of reimbursement that you got from Medicaid. Synergy does not do that at all. So we feel like that's a big plus for us.
So they took a commission. They took kind of a commission on Medicaid.
That's right.
Good call, Rita.
Well, and then I just want to kind of, I think I've made an observation here. We talked earlier about pressures on the capital outlay fund. This is an expense that we had no way of seeing coming, but we could not go without software to manage our IEPs. So tonight we have to purchase something, and this is not an expense that we saw when we created our budget back in July.
I mean, we always anticipate that software is going to go end of life at some point. You always have to do those replacement cycles, but this one came a little bit sooner than we had anticipated. But I think Lady Vizzula would agree with me that this is not something that we want to go back to paper and pencil.
Thank you.
Great. All right. You get a motion for 6.07.
Motion to approve the purchase of special education software from Endpoint for a 5-year cost of $239,071 as presented.
Second.
All right. I have a motion by Mr. Beveridge and a second by Mr. McCune.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Wycliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
All right. We have our last bid contracts. So it's the district notification. So we had the presentation earlier, which looks very neat to be able to get everything mobilized and put it out there and have apps and get all the communication that we want. So anybody have any questions about this?
Well, I will add, I was speaking with Maggie, who did the presentation during the meeting, and she was saying that if you don't have a mobile device, that you still can get the mobile screen on a computer also.
Great.
Which will be nice. I mean, some people don't use their mobile devices for that. So if nobody has any questions, I'll make the motion. Okay, so move to approve the purchase of the Blackboard for their website, web-based hosted communication solution for a total annual cost of $41,510 as presented.
Second.
I have a motion by Mrs. Felter and a second by Mr. McCune.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Wycliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Very good. All right, now we're in the action items. 7.01, special meeting on February 25th. Dr. Berry, that meeting is for?
The intent of that meeting is to come back to you after the bond task force has finished some more meeting time, to come back to you and give you a look without any action that evening at the pieces that we might be presenting. The actual proposal will come, if there is one, on March 3rd, our regular meeting. But we didn't like to walk in with something and on the very first meeting ask you to also consider it. So we will present to you on February 25th if that date still works for most of you.
And I know that we were kind of talking about that, and I think the majority of us can be there, but there'll be a couple of board members that won't be able to attend that. But Dr. Berry said he'll get us caught up for that. So if the 25th still works.
Works for me.
Okay. And there'll be costs associated with.
Yes, absolutely. And again, it'll be a single issue meeting that night starting at 5 o'clock, so we can be fairly efficient in presenting to you.
Right. And there's no action being taken. This is just information coming.
Okay.
Okay.
I'd move to approve a special meeting on Thursday, February 25th, 2016 at 5 p.m.
Second.
I have a motion by Mr. Wycliffe and a second by Ms. Filter.
Mr. Wycliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Very good. Mm-hmm. All right, now we have three student trips, and we can kind of group these together if nobody has any questions about it. 7.02, 7.03, and 7.04.
There it is.
Okay.
I would move to approve 7.02, 7.03, and 7.04 student trips as presented.
Second.
A motion by Mr. McCune and a second by Mr. Wycliffe.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Mr. Wickliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Shear?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
All right. Future action items. We've got a whole list here. Dr. Berry, is there anyone in particular, or is there any questions from any board members on any of these in particular?
Some are just maintenance items, but they are singletons that don't come up very often, like our Lone Elm building. It needs some restructuring a little bit from some of the bins that we hold salt and sand in. The ODAC bleacher repair is just something that we monitor. Those bleachers have been in for a long time, and we think at this point we can do a little bracing to those to improve the strength, and so that's been proposed. We'll be bringing the facility usage fees to you, but at this point we're not proposing any increase in those. That helps our community.
And then several different trips. Any other questions? Anybody from the board? Okay. Very good. Written information. We had written information from the Head Start and also construction change orders. Topics for discussion. Any board members have any specific topics they'd like to bring up today? No? If not, then we'll turn it back over to you, Dr. Berry.
Birthdays are very exciting. It's always fun to pick something to do either with your family or go out to eat or whatever it might be. It's nice that Brent McCune decided to spend his with us tonight. So happy birthday, Brent. Kansas Association of School Boards always does a webinar to update us, and the webinar tomorrow is talking about the pace of the session. They are sensing that the pace is starting to pick up, and again, you've heard some legislators talk about it might be possible to have a short session and not go historically long like last year. So things are going to start to happen here pretty quick, because even they might be talking about moving up the turnaround time where all bills had to be presented by a week at least. So we'll continue to try to monitor what's happening. Senate Bill 368 is something that we're watching that might come up for a vote as early as next week, but it deals with the information that can be put out on bond issues and elections. We already know under current statute that we cannot use any of our district equipment, time, facilities, and so forth to promote, to advocate for or against a candidate. But when you have an election like bond issues, in the past, we've always been able to put out factual information. Well, this is a change that says no municipality shall use government funds to distribute or cause to be distributed any brochure, flyer, political fact sheet, or other document regarding any question submitted election. So the interpretation by Mark Tolman says it would prohibit us from even providing information explaining why a question is on the ballot. So again, we don't try and sway people, but we usually would put out, here's the need, you know, and what we're trying to propose. So we'll watch this as it comes up, and may want to weigh in on that next week. We always continue to have wonderful staff members in our district who are recognized for various things. I'd like to highlight tonight that Dr. Allison Banikowski was recently named as an honored administrator for KMEA in the state, and will be receiving an award later this month, maybe, I think, mid-February, might be next week, in fact. So congratulations to Dr. Banikowski for that. Might be following also that there is a lot of talk about efficiencies, obviously, in the state, and at the state level, maybe pooling together so that all school districts would go together for health insurance. Dale Dennis, who we follow pretty closely, obviously, in terms of our guidelines, has indicated, in his opinion, there'd be half winners and half losers across the state, meaning as a loser, you might pay more than what you already do. We try to work locally with our professional counsel and look at benefits and how the plans play out. And it's been very important to us that we try to do that locally to meet the needs of our employees. So we're not sure how that might work if you go to a state plan. There currently is a state plan for health insurance that's more expensive than we currently are under. But having said all of that, to try and be a little proactive, the Johnson County Schools are meeting with Johnson County government in the next 3 weeks. To see if there might be something that we could do cooperatively. And so again, I'll be bringing back information on that piece. Through your action tonight on the HR addendum and report, You have named, and it pleases me to announce, our new principal for Olathe West. Olathe West principal will be Jay Novacek. Jay was started his career in our district as a teacher at Olathe South, so he was a Falcon, and then he helped to open Olathe Northwest and serves there as an assistant principal and athletic director. Jay is eager, he's excited, and he is the right person to open Olathe West for us. So we will look forward to having him share in coming months, and even having him be probably presenting sometimes as details come up about Olathe West and the opening of that school. But we're excited to have Jay on board. And the last thing I want to mention is that February 1st is the deadline in our agreement for early retirement in our district, and we have topped the 100 mark again. 106 certified and classified staff members have indicated they'd like to retire. That number was 124 last year, so down slightly. But in terms of certified teachers, it's one more than last year. And then to finalize my comments tonight, I'd like to give a special recognition to one person on that list. I'd like to do it for everybody, but Rita Lyon has been with this district for 28 years, has done tremendous things for us and moved our technology forward, just been outstanding to work with and has done great things for us, and we will certainly miss Rita Lyon. That's all I have.
All right. So are we in need of a executive session?
We do.
How long do you need?
In honor of Brent's birthday, I have just 10 minutes tonight.
10 minutes. Okay, so we'll return back here at 7:50? 55. Make it 7:55. Mr. Poland's not here that usually reads this.
Yeah. Can you call in?
Can somebody make the motion for us, please?
I move that the board adjourn to executive session for the purpose of discussing personnel matters of non-elected personnel, discussing matters relating to employer-employee negotiations, and that the board return to the regular meeting at 7:55 p.m. in this room. The executive session is required in order to protect the privacy interests of the individuals to be discussed, to protect the district's right to the confidentiality of its negotiating position, and the public interest.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Wickliffe, second by Mr. McCune.
Mr. Wickliffe?
Yes.
Mr. Scheer?
Yes.
Mr. Beveridge?
Yes.
Mr. McCune?
Yes.
Mrs. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Felter?
Yes.
Good.